Well, thank you very much for inviting me to speak here today. I enjoy being back at the meeting. I remember visiting in 2014. So today I'm going to share with you an update on the method I developed and how we've been applying it around the world. And I look forward to getting your questions. So starting out, I'll be talking about water sensing with reflected GPS GNSS signals. Things I'll be talking about today will be to first introduce the technique to you because it's relatively new. And then I'll primarily focus on environmental sensing, and then I'll end up with some new work I've been doing. So first, I just want to make it clear, I think everybody knows what GPS is. It's in your cell phone, it's in your car navigation system, which I'm showing here that the general public uses, but today we live in what's called GNSS world, which is Global Navigation Satellite Systems. And this is a world that includes signals, not just from GPS, but from the European system, the Russian system, and the Chinese system. So I think while I won't focus on it, I want you to know why I call it GNSS interferometric reflectometry, because all the signals can be used. And the things I talked about 7 years ago, basically you can do 120 satellites now, whereas back then we could only do about 20 to 30 satellites. So things have really improved. We are using similar equipment to what we used before. Unlike what the general public uses, which is shown on the left, I use more expensive equipment that is typically deployed outside continuously. The antenna is separate from the receiver. This is a site where it snows and it's a little difficult to see, but you might be able to see that there's an equipment box in white in the back of the enclosure, and that's where the receiver is. And the antenna itself has been very expensively attached to the earth so it can measure plate motions, plate tectonics. So I want to just give you a cartoon of how we in the world of earth science use GPS. I'm what's called a geodesist, and the goal of our research is really to calculate the very precise location of where things are. And you can call that latitude, longitude, and height, or in our world, we typically call it X, Y, and Z, where the center of the coordinate system is inside the Earth. We have an antenna, which is quite expensive, and a monument, as I'm showing here. And we have a very more complicated GPS, GNSS receiver than the one you have in your cell phone. But we all get the same signals, and I'm trying to show those signals as these blue signals that are transmitted from multiple satellites in your cell phone, and your car navigation system's calculating where it is every second to tell you where it is. So that's the world I was living in till about 15, 20 years ago. I was a geodesist who calculated locations, positions. But at that point, I started thinking about what can we do with the signals that reflect off the surface of the Earth before they arrive at the antenna? So you'll still get the signals that arrive first, but you'll also get these reflections or echoes, if you want to think of them that way. And those echoes are going to be used to measure H, what I'm calling capital H, which is the distance between the surface of the Earth and the antenna. And that could be useful for measuring things about how wet the soil is, how much snow is on the ground. If it's a lake or a river, you could calculate the lake height, the river height. If there was vegetation on the surface of the Earth, you could calculate something about the vegetation. The physics are basically a straightforward interferometry type of experiment that you learned about in freshman physics. Basically, we have a beating pattern created by two signals, one that arrives directly to the antenna and the second signal reflects. And that interference pattern has a beating that has a frequency that tells us about H, which is the height above the surface. It's really easy to see the effect of the beating pattern on GPS signals if we look at power data. So this is power or signal to noise ratio data. The black line is the real data. The blue line is sort of a simple smooth fit through that. That's the direct signal. The power is very smoothly varying over the 6 hours that the signal is visible at this site. But these things at the beginning and also at the end, if I can extract the frequency at the beginning of the data or at the end of the data, I can tell you how high this antenna is above the surface of the earth. And I can also tell you how wet the soil is, how much vegetation is on it. So I'm basically reverse engineering these little patterns at the beginning and the ends of the time series. Why would you want to do this? Well, we just don't have enough soil moisture sensors in the world. A lot of people, it's very expensive to maintain these networks, and people have not been able to maintain them. And they have very small footprints, typically, tens of centimeter squared volumes. Satellites, you'd like to think, can measure everything. They simply don't, and they don't work well in some conditions. Most satellites that try to measure snow don't work in mountains, so they're useless. Soil moisture can be very challenging to measure when there's vegetation present. These GNSS data that I'm going to be sharing with you were collected by somebody else. They were collected by geodesists like myself, people that are measuring plate motions, and they are willing to share their data for free. We also were providing a data source for people that do satellite validation, if we could do this with GPS. We first pioneered this technique by measuring soil moisture, snow depth, and biomass. We were lucky in that when we came up with these ideas, a new GPS network was being built in the Western United States. Not for me, but to measure plate motions. And typically, geodesists show the effects of plate tectonics by telling you how fast the plate is moving. And what you can see on the right-hand side is the Pacific plate is moving at 50 millimeters per year. So the length of the arrows are bigger. On the left-hand side of the plot, if you were in Nevada or Texas or Colorado where I live, the arrows are quite small. And that means we're on a slower part of the plate. So that was the purpose of this network. It was never meant to be used to measure soil moisture or snow. But we were in fact able to measure snow at about 230 sites. These are the sites we used. We did some validation. This was the blue is our measurement of snow depth, which is in a sort of a field, maybe the size of a football field. It's a typical American thing to talk about as a football field. The red is validation at the pole where the antenna was. So they're not quite the same place, but they're close, and they show you that there's pretty good agreement between the two methods. And in fact, once we started our project to measure snow depth every day, we were able to operate that network for 5 years into the future, but we were also able to go back and look at the older data and put together a climate record over, like, it looks like 12 years. We also probably were best known for measuring soil moisture, which is really difficult to measure. It would work really well in arid regions. It is difficult to use the technique in very dense vegetation, but it works beautifully in arid and semi-arid areas. And this happens to be from this particular site, a grassland. And what's shown in blue at the bottom is when it rained. What's shown in gray is the range of five different in situ sensors, water content reflectometers, and the colored circles are GPS. So you see really good correspondence between the two methods, one method where the sensors are buried and one when we're using GPS reflections. This is a record we created for a site, my hometown, San Diego, where it never rains. But basically, we did get it right when it did rain. Soil moisture went up, and that's shown in the blue at the top. This is another site in eastern New Mexico. Here, it rains a little bit more often. We've also shown some MET data for the site, but we don't use it in our algorithm. It's just a reality check that when it rains, soil does get wet. We also were able to look at attenuated signals due to vegetation growth. We're using the data to look at vegetation season. How long was the season for the vegetation growth and things like that? This happens to be a site in California. And what you see in the top is our attenuation measurement. Basically, it's a normalized measurement that shows you very clearly when vegetation water content increases and then decreases. You can see it's a very narrow growing season in California climate. There is a song we talk about in California, it never rains in Southern California. That's pretty much true. I grew up with very little rain. What's shown in the bottom is an optical sensing measurement called NDVI. You can see that the season length that it's measuring is longer, and that doesn't mean that we're right or they're wrong. It just means they measure something else. So greenness, the color of the vegetation, is different than the actual water content. What we're showing in the middle is the five-year average for cumulative precipitation from a model in black, and then that particular year's in red. And you can see pretty easily that the first season was a very low vegetation year, and that's shown in both measurements. We were able to use the data from the experiment to measure plate motions to look at vegetation in California over 9 years, because a lot of the sensors were in California. California is the location of the major plate boundary between the North American and Pacific plates. Basically, red is drought, and blue, things are good, and cyan is, well, it's okay. It's about average. And yellow's on the way to red. And there was a, you know, we look back, it was a big deal at the time. There was a very significant drought in California. And the reason it concerned people so much is it went on for multiple years. Of course, there are occasional droughts. And you can see in 2007, up in the upper left, there was a huge drought. But this one was very long lasting and then ended with some heavy rains in 2015 for most locations. After I visited with you in 2014, I became more interested in measuring sea level. This happens to be a site in Alaska. The method we developed to measure soil moisture can also be used to measure sea level. As long as the GPS site is close enough to the shore, we just look at the reflections off the water surface. It just has to be smooth, planar. This happens to be a site with very large tides. But we use the same data. So I showed that to you because I think visually you can see the sine waves on the left-hand side. If I put the sine waves on the left-hand side and the sine wave on the right-hand side into a periodogram, I'd get the same frequency because it happens to be in a level agricultural field in Boulder, Colorado. So it's measuring the height of the antenna above the surface. This is what it looks like when you're trying to measure tides. Here, it's about the same amount of time. It's about 5 hours. On the left-hand side, you can see that the sine waves have a much higher frequency than on the right-hand side. The frequency is much lower. Well, that's because on the left-hand side, that's at low tide. And then on the right side, at UTC 11, it's low tide. I'm sorry, high tide. Sorry. So you can very visually connect these data, I think, to low tide and high tide and see what's going on. Now, we do that for every rising and setting satellite track, and we get something like this. This was something we put together in 2012 and published in 2013. But just to remind people, tides can be quite huge. This happens to be peak-to-peak 8 meters, and yet the GPS measurement, which was installed to measure plate motions. It's installed to measure the deformation below the Alaskan subcontinent, if you will. So very good agreement between the two, between GPS and the real tide gauge. We also then looked at the same kind of metrics over a longer period. This is a year-long comparison in 2008. Agreement's better than 2 centimeters. We did a comparison over 10 years, the agreement's 1.3 centimeters. So it gives you the advantage also that you're using a GPS equipment, GPS instrument that tells you location. And that can be valuable because our Earth is changing, climate's changing. The location of these sites change, not just from climate, but also from earthquakes. If you aren't able to measure that, you would mistake water level change with something that's actually, the surface is changing. Another thing that we tried was to measure ice sheets, snow accumulation on ice sheets. This happens to be on the Greenland ice sheet. This particular GPS site was installed by seismologists. They were putting in a bunch of seismic instruments. So They put a GPS receiver to measure how fast the ice sheet was moving. But I looked at this and thought, well, maybe I can see reflections from the ice and that would tell me when it snowed. And look at the bottom of that antenna. There's a sort of a wooden base. Look at it. That was 2011. Look at 2012. There's been so much melt of the ice in 2012 that now the monument is above the ice. And then the field crew took pictures every year and then I lined them up. So you can see that in this location, not only did they have that big ice melt, they also had accumulation over the next 5 years. We used it and were able to measure snow accumulation. Here we have an 8-year record. Eventually it would get buried in snow and they had to extend the pole. So we've corrected for that. So that's another application of GPS interferometric reflectometry. Let me get to my new things. Hopefully we'll have time. Last fall, like everybody else in the United States, I was mostly at home. But some things on the news caught my interest. We had several hurricanes in the Louisiana area. This happened to be a place where there was a GPS site next to a tide gauge, and it happened to be under the eye of the hurricane. So what's shown below is a map of the hurricane. The cyan star is actually the location of the GPS. And one of the ways you can tell that the eye of the hurricane's passing over you is the wind speed goes to zero. And that's shown in this plot in the red. You can see that the wind speeds were quite high, then they dropped. And then as it moved away, they went back up again. But there's a decaying on both sides. What's shown in blue are the NOAA tide gauge measurements in this hurricane, which was category 3 or 4, I don't recall which. It wasn't 4 by the time it got there, but it was 4 offshore. And what's in cyan are the GPS measurements of water level. So here's a case where we can show that it's not only a tide gauge, but it works during hurricanes as well and could be used to measure storm surges. The other thing I looked at last summer was the effects from a tsunami created by a magnitude 8 earthquake in Alaska. This was on the Shumagin Islands. And the short story is that not only can you measure tides or storm surges, but you can also measure tsunami waves. So that's the short story. I want to just finish up with some thoughts. We developed soil moisture techniques, snow depth techniques, vegetation, and we ran a network in the Western US to do that. I retired in 2018 from my faculty position, and I've thought a lot about the things that my group did. And I worked with a lot of people that traditional geodesists don't work with. And by that, I really mean environmental scientists. Usually we work with people that study earthquakes and volcanoes. The other thing academics in general and geodesists do is we write papers. We don't publish code or haven't in the past. And environmental scientists need data, but we analyzed the data for them up through 2018, but at that point, the source of the data wasn't there anymore. So I guess I got to thinking that we really shouldn't force people to become experts on this method to use it. So I've been trying to think of ways to improve access to scientific techniques by environmental scientists. A lot of environmental scientists that I've worked with just want the results. And I think that's fine. And they should have access to that. And one way, at least in the United States, you know, everybody's gotten used to just, you know, buy it on the internet. So I've made a web app, which is essentially on-demand calculation of environmental parameters. So you just submit your data file, or if it's in an archive, you tell me the name of the station and the year and the day and you hit submit. And we're all kind of used to that when we buy things. So it's a little bit different to think that that might be how you do science, but as long as the models in the web app are traceable, why would you care, right? It's the same code. So there are examples there for soil moisture, snow, water levels, and so on, but also it's a working web app. The other kind of people are the ones who are willing to install the code if it exists, and they're willing to use it, but it's a special subset of people. A lot of people, and I speak primarily here of geodesists, aren't interested in environmental science. So they're the ones who know the most about GNSS and GPS, but they're not interested. So we have to make it easier for them as well to run this code. And that way environmental scientists could use it too if they wanted, if they didn't want to use the web app. So we've made a open source Python package and it's online. Right now it supports water levels and snow, and we'll be adding soil moisture in the next year. So the last group are those who are trying to make this technique better. And I'm hoping by having an open source code that everyone can contribute, and people won't have to start writing their own codes from the beginning. So this is a work in progress. We're hoping to also support people that are using cheaper receivers, which use slightly different formats, and wish us luck. Thank you.